Now in its 10th year, this is GabNet. Talk like you've never heard it before.
Hey everybody, live from Harlem in New York City, it's me, Alex, and this is The Ramble. Ladies and gentlemen, there he is, of course, as always, the lovely, the attractive, the bon vivant. You have a, there's some kind of like, I guess it's something in your reflection in your glasses that's red. Are you looking at a monitor that's red?
No, these have a new anti-glare. These are new glasses. So the anti-glare is
anti-glare,
red.
But then it puts in red.
Yeah, but I don't see it, so I don't care.
Oh, okay. Well, we see it, you know, but...
Joy.
But we care. So how's everything down in Florida?
I guess okay. Nothing new. It's the same stuff. No COVID, though.
You said you're thinking of moving out of Florida?
Always.
Always?
Mm-hmm.
Well, you wound up down there because your mother lived there, right?
No. Well, my parents did, but my in-laws live here now.
Yeah.
So we live not far from them, and it's good to be close to people who are older.
You like that?
Do I like what specifically?
You like being with people who are older.
No, I don't care for that. But I like that we're near them in case they need something.
In case you need them. You would think
they
the older people would
need us.
Well, you would think the older people would need you.
That's what I just said, in case they need something.
Oh, okay.
Not us. We don't.
So you don't care about me. I'm 84 years old. I can use all the help I can get.
Well, then you better move down here by me. They get priority.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Unfortunately, that's the way it goes.
But you're coming up for a couple of days, so can you take care of us?
That all depends on what taking care of means. If it means any kind of medical procedure or a personal body contact, then no.
No. Oh, okay.
Otherwise, okay, yes.
Because we have our problems, you know.
Everybody has their problems.
I'm going to physical therapy every week.
Well, I would expect that probably starting in the 70s, you would maybe people would think about they would have to do that at some point. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, I'm going through physical therapy because of my neuropathy.
Oh, okay.
And because I've been falling a lot lately.
Huh.
You know.
Why are you falling?
I don't know. I'm just falling. I took a fall right on my face a couple of weeks ago. You heard about that. You saw the pictures, didn't you?
I don't think so, no.
Oh, right on my face. I was bloodied and scarred and everything. In fact, notice part of my mustache is gone.
Hmm. And you did that outside or inside?
Inside, right outside. Right outside our building.
And so you had your cane or your walker or whatever you use now?
Yep, I had that.
And you fell in spite of that?
Yes.
Because you don't pick your feet up and you drag them?
Well, that could be. Hmm. But that's part of the neuropathy.
Oh, right, yes, you can't feel.
I mean, it's like I'm happy to raise my feet as much as I can when I walk, and I used to. But now I have a certain slide that takes place because of the neuropathy.
Right.
So they have these exercises. The thing I hate about physical therapy, I've said this before, is you have homework. You know, they only spend like 45 minutes with you there working things and working with you on things, and then they send you home and have you do them every day. And I'm going, shouldn't physical therapy take care of that when I go to them?
Yeah, but that's what it is, physical therapy. They tell you what to do, and you do it.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
What a racket.
It's not a racket.
Well,
it's therapy. They're not going to do it for you. You have to do the work.
Yeah, well, I do my exercises every day.
Good. Well, that's what you're supposed to do.
Yes, I'm a good boy.
All right.
You know,
they're not going to fall.
They're not much. You know, there's some leg things and 30 reps of legs, and then lifting my spine 30 reps, and then I have a stand-up thing, which I do 20 reps. Getting off a chair, and then I do a balance thing in the kitchen against a counter, in which I try to balance without touching the counter, which is kind of impossible for me because my motion is all screwed up. So
you ask me if I like to hang out with old people, and I said not necessarily. But I generally do not care to hang out with old people because this is what I get all the time.
Well, yes.
People complaining about being old.
No. As an older person, let me inform you, you ageist son of a bitch.
And so what? So what?
What?
It's nothing to do with being ageist because I won't do it when I'm your age either. Nor do I care to hear it when I'm
your age. No, you think you won't. But the fact is, you get a bunch of old people together, okay, in a room, let's say dinner, and I guarantee you within 5 minutes they're talking about their medical ills.
And I guarantee you I walk away from that.
No, but I guarantee you if you get to 84, you will be that way.
I hang out with people that are in their 80s. They don't ever talk about shit like this. They have the 5 minute time period, and then it's over. Ooh. There are other things to talk about.
Oh, of course, we talk about
liver and the pains and the aches and the who cares about that? Move on. There's more to life than that.
I mean, every morning I wake up to my wife saying to me, "My back is killing me."
Then why say it every morning?
Well, I know.
Hear it every morning. Stop saying it.
You know, it's a given that her back is going to ache.
Then Marjorie should stop saying that.
Well, when you're here, will you tell her that?
Sure.
Oh, okay.
Sure.
All right.
Do you tell her that you don't want to hear it?
I don't tell her I don't want to hear it because then I'll get a bunch of crap back and, you know.
So you get crap back, and she'll tell you that she doesn't want to hear your stuff either.
Do I mind hearing it? She's my wife. It's my duty to hear it.
No, no.
What do you mean, duty to hear
old people complaining about their ailments? That's nobody's duty.
You haven't gotten to this point yet. You haven't gotten to the point where...
This is my point. I don't want to get to this point where I have to listen to people talk about shit about their health. I don't care. And most people don't care.
But
I get into the pool and into the hot tub and people start talking about that shit. And I put my earbuds in so I don't have to listen to that. There's so much more to deal with in life than to hear about people's ailments and problems. It's enough already. I give you 5 minutes, and that's it. That's it for the ailments.
But you don't understand.
I obviously don't. Whatever you're going to say, I obviously don't understand.
You really don't understand. You don't understand that I wake up in the morning, and I just ache. I have aches and pains, you know.
Yeah, it's not that I don't understand because you say it all the time. I do understand. I just don't have to hear it over and over again. It's not that I don't want to hear it.
Only because at your age, if you were 84, you'd be sympathetic.
Well, if that's what's going to happen when I'm 84, I hope never to make it to 84.
Well, you may not make it to
84. I'd rather make it just to the point where I don't have to talk about my health.
You may not make it to 84. You're coming to visit us, and if you come with that attitude, I'll kill you.
It's not possible. You'll fall down before you get to me.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, all I'm saying is, what did somebody call it? When a bunch of old people get together to have lunch, their discussion is an organ recital?
Yeah. That's why I'm not going to get together with that group. Whatever group you're getting together with.
Oh, I won't even take you to visit them.
Please don't.
I don't want you to be part of the group.
I'm asking you not to.
Actually, I don't have that group. See, I don't have friends. I really don't. My friends are dying. Most of them are dead. I had my friend, remember my friend Bruce?
Yeah.
Dead. My friend Shecky? Dead. My friend Roy out in California, who was my lifelong friend? Dead. Everybody that I know that I would spend time with possible exception of you, is dead.
But why now do we have to transition from ailments and body problems to people who are dead? What, you've got to get away from this old person mindset of conversation that really has nothing to do with anybody but you. And I know it's your show, and I know it's your podcast, and I know that's it, but there's got to be more to talk about than this.
Talk about this on my show.
This is your show now.
We're talking about it now, but we're talking about being able to understand that as you get to be our age. I mean, I used to feel the way you did, too. But then when you get to be our age, it is important. I mean, Marjorie wakes up every day with aches and pains. I wake up I have a certain problem walking and doing things like that, you know. And so these are all things that have slowed us down. Marjorie was a very active, athletic
person. Yeah, but we all
know
this. We all know this. But we don't want to hear about it constantly. It's got to stop. There's more to life than that. You got to talk about other shit because this is...
Okay, tell me what shit I should talk about.
Pick something else. Pick another topic. Stuff to talk about.
Politics,
if you want to. That's another thing that's been... I'll talk about that at the start of the new year. We can talk about that. Now, there's nothing new to talk about in politics. It's the same jazz.
It's the same stuff over and over again.
Yeah.
Marjorie watches that damn MSNBC. And I keep telling her, why do you watch this? It's the same thing over and over again. You know that for an hour they're going to bash Trump.
Because she likes that affirmation.
And they don't remember that when they spent all their time bashing Trump back in 2016, they got him elected without him having to spend a penny in advertising.
Not even the same thing. It's not even equatable. You're talking apples and bowling balls. They're not the same thing.
Why?
2016 and 2024 are completely different animals.
They are different animals. But all I'm saying is that you can get somebody elected by just constantly talking bad about them.
I don't know if it's as simple as that, then many people would have been elected that weren't elected. It's not that's not how you get people elected.
No, I mean, there used to be a time where if somebody had raped somebody or somebody had. Done whatever he's supposed, paid off porn stars, there'd be no way they'd even get nominated, let alone elected. But the fact that you have a guy like Trump who's this close to winning, even though he's behind Kamala Harris now, but he's just that he's got a 44% or whatever, makes you question what our values have become, that there are 44% of the people out there who will vote for a rapist, porn star paying offer, just a horrible human being. And you know it, and I know it, and you lived with it here in New York, and you always said Trump was a big crook, right? And yet there are people who will vote for this guy.
There are people who will vote for anybody. Who cares?
People who vote for anybody? But we're talking about this. I mean, it just amazes me. It boggles my mind. I mean, what cats and dogs are being eaten by Haitians in Springfield? Come on. That's enough for you to say, I'm washing my hands of this guy. He's crazy.
That's if you're someone who does the research and looks at what are those things called?
The cat and dog ratio to Haitians.
No, it's a pointless conversation because people that believe that stuff are not going to move off that line.
By the way, you go to Asia, and dog is delicious.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I believe you.
I have a guy who lives in Malaysia, says they serve dog over there.
I don't see why it shouldn't be delicious. It's the same. It's essentially the same stuff as cow and deer. It's
and
just,
it probably tastes just like chicken.
Probably does taste similar.
Why is it that everything almost tastes like chicken?
Because it's essentially the same stuff. It's a meat protein. They essentially all taste the same. Yeah. Alligator tastes like chicken. They all taste the same.
I don't know any group of people though that eat kitty cats.
I'm sure they do it in some Asian countries.
Really, kitty cat?
Yeah. And why not?
I mean, you couldn't kill them. They just look at you with those eyes going, please don't.
Oh, there are people who can kill them. There are people who could kill anybody or anything.
Where's your cat today, by the way? He's usually in back of you, resting in the sun.
Sitting on the floor here next to me.
Oh, really? Oh, okay. How old is he?
She's maybe 15 years old now.
Really? So she sleeps a lot, right?
All cats sleep a lot.
Yeah. Well, but as they get older, they even get worse. Do you know the male lion sleeps 22 hours a day?
I would, too, if I were the male lion. Who's going to bother me?
But you got to take care of the pride. You gotta keep the other lions away.
No.
You think that's more than a two-hour-day job?
Does that.
I mean, what happens? One lion comes along and tries to wrest the pride from this other lion, and the other lion says to him, "Well, not now. I'm resting."
No, the other lion will kick his ass, and then will rest, and then the rest of the work gets done by the lioness. She takes care.
Oh, the lioness it takes care of everything. She hunts. Mm-hmm. She, you know. Raises the kitty cats.
Yeah.
I think nature probably has it way over us.
What part of nature? What are you talking about?
All nature. You know, it has a certain balance that it maintains that human beings just don't seem to maintain.
Human beings don't control nature. As much as they'd like to, they don't control nature, and they will not control nature. And you know, I was thinking the other day, forget about nuclear war, forget about everything else. We're past the point of climate change that it is not going to affect us adversely. So just accept the fact that humanity will not be around for many more generations, because the climate will continue to change in an adverse way for the life of humanity, and humans will go away.
And who's to fault for that?
Humans.
Humans.
Yeah. So what? So
but that's
what?
Because we don't have a relationship with nature.
No, that's not it. That's not it. It's because there. If you want to put three things in order, nature is one of the top things, right?
Okay.
Nature, very powerful force. But there's another powerful force, even more powerful than nature, when humans are involved, and that is money. Money is more powerful than nature. So if it involves getting money and nature gets in the way, nature loses. And there's even one more powerful force than money, and that is the human ego. And whatever it takes to boost the human ego, even if money is not involved, that's what will happen. Nature is maybe third, maybe less than that. So forget about nature being on top. We don't care about nature. We never have really cared about nature. Maybe in the early days of humanity when that's all there was. But with technology,
I think there was a point early on. I mean, before all the mechanization and technology and so on and so forth, that man knew he had to live with nature. You know, I mean, you go out in the early days of the United States and you have a cabin out in the woods somewhere and a little farm attached to it, and you're living with nature. And you're having to live with nature, not against it.
But we don't live in a society like that anymore. We don't care about that.
But we live in a society.
You and I don't need to live with nature at all, at all. You and I need to live with money. If we don't have money, we cannot live. Doesn't matter. We don't need to worry about, oh, the farm and the crops aren't coming up this year and the cows aren't growing as fat. It doesn't matter to us. That's what's gone by the wayside. And because of it, we just don't care about nature. And it doesn't matter because nature would come and kick our ass anyway. So it doesn't matter.
Yeah, nature's going to win. There's no question about it. You want to pick a fight with nature, nature's going to win. You cannot, and people go, oh, gee, we have all these wildfires in California. They don't realize that's part of global warming.
Part of the climate of the globe. I don't know about global warming.
Yeah, but I mean, are there more fires than there used to be? Yes. Are there more hurricanes, tornadoes, all kinds of things? Yes.
But that has happened in the past. That has happened several times in the past where the climate of the earth has just become so extreme that a lot of life couldn't survive.
Only once.
It's happened several times.
There were several events, excuse me. But the one that we think about the most was the last major one that got rid of the dinosaurs and the life on Earth, and then life started again. And since then, we have not had one of those events.
But from what I've seen of the science, the dinosaurs were destroyed by an asteroid that changed the climate substantially and killed many species on this planet. There have been other times where that has happened without an asteroid coming into the Earth's proximity.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the things we need to look at. We would have needed to look at if this weren't going to happen. But this is already done. This is finished. There is no coming back from this. You may want to create some kind of suit that you can live in the extreme environment. But aside from that, the kids have to prepare for a lot of hot weather that's not usually in places that is hot, and cold weather that's not usually in places that's cold. And it's going to happen. And just deal with it like you deal with everything else.
But if we can prevent that from happening.
It can't be prevented.
It can be prevented. It can be slowed. It certainly can be slowed down.
By what? I'm so sick and tired of hearing this nonsense about your footprint and reducing carbon emissions. It's not happening. It is not happening, and it will not happen
because
we care about money.
Yeah, but do you
we don't
agree,
care about this.
Do you agree it should not happen, that we should be aware of it, and we should do everything to stop it, and stop with this looking at money as being the most important thing in the world?
But that's not going to change. It's not going to change. Why is everybody thinking that we're gonna be able to swing this around? Oh, we'll be able to change it.
I have a solution. Let's make money illegal.
How about just live your life and enjoy your life and stop doing all the nonsense?
I would like to, but other people are fucking with it. You know, I mean, for instance,
other people will always fuck with it.
I'm paying a lot of money for what we call Medicare supplemental because they never gave us Medicare where it takes care of 100%. And why?
Well, that's just
because
a great
some
country
money
you live
people
in.
Had to be satisfied. Not me, not an old guy who needs his Medicare. I'm paying $350 a month to get supplemental so that the other 20% is taken care of. And by the way, they're also taking money out of my Social Security for Medicare. So between the two, I'm paying like $500 a month. And really, at my age, shouldn't I just be taken care of?
That would be nice, but that doesn't happen in this world.
Yeah, well, that's why I'm saying we should make money. We should make money in the pursuit of it illegal.
No, that's not right either. That's not right either. That's not the answer either. Responsible capitalism is the answer.
Happen. Okay. There's another dream you're living with, responsible capitalism.
Oh, it is a dream. It's not going to happen.
Well, I think the terms are fighting against each other.
What's that?
Responsible and capitalism.
I don't think so at all. I don't think so at all. There's a way to be financially successful and take care of people.
Well, we can discuss this next time because we're running out of time here.
And as long as we don't discuss the health problems of an 84-year-old man next time.
Okay, we won't. I promise you we won't. All right? Ladies and gentlemen, that's him. That's Albert Reynoso. Thank you, Albert.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Now in its 10th year, this is GabNet. Talk like you've never heard it before.
Oh, yeah. We love Albert, don't we? Yeah, he's okay. He's all right. He's our man. If he can't do it, nobody can. Beep, 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 boom, boom. I think I got to turn on the air conditioner. I keep thinking it's getting cold enough now that I don't have to turn on the air conditioner. And it is in the rest of the house. But in here, I got a little bit of heat. Little bit of heat. Anyway, what are we going to do here? Let me see. Let me turn my couple of things down over here. Got to set things up. And we have one person waiting to be on our little extravaganza here. So let me bring him in, and we will, let me see here, bring him in here now, and I think, wait a minute, where, what?
I'm here.
You're there, but, oh, you're kind of there. Hello there, Josh, how are you?
Good, how you doing? Sorry, I had to get up for something real quick.
Oh, it's okay. And it's you and I. That's it. You and I.
That'll make the people in your chat very unhappy.
Very unhappy. Well, a couple of them were complaining about you last week or something. You know? Mm-hmm. What was that about? Because I don't pay attention to that chat.
I have to ask them, I guess. I believe they feel that I speak too much, but we've had this off air before. When no one else is talking, you would like for me to talk. So anytime someone would like to speak, they may go for as long as they want.
All you have to do is call, and he will give way to you to let you speak as well, right? Because he's one of the more decent people that calls this program.
So. Be more than happy to if they would like to.
Yep. Hello.
It's easier to type insulting and
he's our man.
Personal derogatory remarks about Jeff.
Hold on a second. Jeff.
I'm done.
You got it? Yeah. Oh, okay. Fine. Anyway, now where were we? We were talking about people who were complaining, and they never call the show.
Okay.
You know? They're always out there. They're always ready to complain. I appreciate the existence of Josh. Primarily because sometimes we don't get a lot of people who call, and he's the one who participates when he calls. So, you know, you're welcome to call yourself and participate as well. We don't care, right? If I have nobody else to go to, then I guess he's going to be on a lot. Okay. All right. Okay. So get used to it. I don't even know which one of these people was dissing you last week, but I don't think that's very nice. Okay, I think it and I think the internet is a place where people learn how to be cruel.
Well, yeah, that's certainly not exclusive to YouTube and GabNet. That's for sure. I mean, a lot of people type things they wouldn't otherwise say.
Well,
for sure.
They feel they can be cruel because they don't have to own up to it. Because, they're anonymous. They're anonymous. basically. Even if there's a name up there, they're kind of anonymous. I don't know. There's a guy here, John Redshaw. He calls all, writes all the time. But I don't know that that's his real name. I don't know that that's really him. I'm not trying to put you down, John, when I'm singling you out. He says, in fact, I like Josh.
Oh.
Yeah. So, anyway. But the fact is, we don't know that he's really John Redshaw. You know, you can be anybody you want to be on the internet. Hey, I'm not really even Alex Bennett. Okay?
Yeah. You know?
And so you don't have to own up to it. You don't have to own up to stuff you say, so you can get downright mean, and nobody's going to call you to account for it. So, yeah. Anyway.
Hey,
baby. Yeah. How you doing, Jeff?
I'm good. It's a nice day.
Yeah.
And, you know, I got to go to listen to the bar mitzvah stuff.
Oh, really?
Temple stuff.
Oh, temple stuff. Not bar mitzvah stuff, but temple stuff. Yeah. Oh, yeah, today's Passover, isn't it? Or not Passover. Yeah. It's Rosh Hashanah.
Got it.
Yeah. Hey, I'm still enough of a Jew, I remember it's Rosh Hashanah.
That's nice.
Because then in about 10 days, we get Yom Kippur, which is the highest holy day of the year.
Correct.
Yeah. I named my dog after it. And everybody thought, that's terrible, Alex. How can you name your... His name was... We named him Kippur. We got him on Yom Kippur, so we called him Kippur. Mm. You know, it would have been worse if we called him Yom. You know, so anyway, so it's Yom Kippur, and it's the that's the highest holy day that's coming up.
Yeah.
You know, that's the one. That's the holiday that made me kind of quit being a Jew. Let me explain why. I was in the Navy. I was stationed in Los Angeles. I didn't have much money. I was only making what they paid me, right, in the Navy, and plus a stipend for living off base because I was living in Hollywood. So now it comes to Yom Kippur, and it's the first year after my father has died. And I want to go to Kol Nidre, which is the highest holy service ever anywhere in the universe. Okay? Am I right? Yep. And so I wanted to go to, you know, Kol Nidre. And I call up one of the shuls in Hollywood. And I said to them, I'd like to come to the Yom Kippur services because my father just died. And I want to honor him by being there. And I felt compelled to do it. And they said, well, you know, it's going to cost $500. And I said to them, well, I know it probably costs $500, but I don't have it. I happen to be in the Navy right now, and I'm stationed in Hollywood, and I would, you know, I don't have the money. So do you have any dispensation for that? And they went, no, you got to come up with the $500. And that was it. And that was me, and going to shul, okay, to ever going back to a synagogue. Because I just, that was so terrible. It was horrible, you know? So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. You know?
That is a little excessive.
Well, you know,
at that time, $500, I would, $500 is a lot of money now, but man, $500 and...
Hey, it was a Hollywood synagogue, my friend.
Yeah.
You know? I mean, they were not cheap. And I understood, you know, that they charge for this and so on and so forth. But don't you have some exception for a guy who's in the Navy, who's in the military service? And especially since his father just died and he'd like to go to the Yom Kippur service. I think Kol Nidre is the song, isn't it, Jeff, that they sing? Yeah, that's the song they sing. Basically, it's just Yom Kippur. It's the services for the Yom Kippur.
The Kaddish.
Kaddish. Okay, fine. See how much of a Jew I am now?
I have to ask my wife. My Christian wife. She knows more about this than
she probably knows, yeah, more about it than you do. So that kind of pissed me off. So, you know. And then Marjorie says to me, "So what are we doing for Rosh Hashanah, which is the Jewish New Year? What year is this? Do you know what year it is?" Echo, no. What Jewish year is this? Okay. We are living in the future.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Hello?
Huh?
Oh. I can hear you now.
Sorry, I thought I was on mute or something. My mic wasn't working.
We can hear you. Sorry. Okay. Yeah. So anyway, so we have a new year here. I don't know. Do we have a ball drop at all? I don't think so. No. No.
Mm-hmm.
No, we don't have anything like that. We just, you know. But we're happy. It's a happy holiday. You know, so
what the hell's wrong with New York? They should have a ball drop there.
They should have a ball drop for it, right?
Yeah.
You know, it's funny though. Every year at Christmas time, you know, they have the big, the big Christmas tree in Rockefeller Center, yeah. And over in Central Park, we have a gigantic menorah. You don't know that, Jeff?
No, I don't go there.
It's a huge menorah. It's just incredibly large menorah. But it isn't as big as the Christmas tree in Rockefeller Center. And until it is, I'm not going to be satisfied.
When I was a kid, I'd always go around the holiday time to New York and to see that huge Christian thing.
Christian thing? You mean the Christmas tree?
The tree,
yeah. The big Gentile. You know what? I'll tell you what bothered me about it, okay? Of course, everything bothers me about stuff, right? But every year they go up to northern New York State, and they find a beautiful tree that's maybe 100 years old. They chop it down and lug it down to New York City and put it up in Rockefeller Center. Yeah. Now, my feeling is that's a 100-year-old tree. Let it be 101, okay? Don't go around chopping it down all the time and putting it in Rockefeller Center. That always pissed me off.
There's usually some story behind it with the family and the whole bit, too.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Four generations grew up under this tree. We used to have a tire swing, la, 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 the whole bit.
Yeah. And now we're letting you chop it down and lug it down to New York City.
Just so we can be on TV for a month.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's just not right. It's just not right. So.
Go out there and hug that tree, Alex.
I'll go hug that tree. You're right. I'm going to go be a tree hugger. Hug it. Hug it. Yeah. So anyway, What was I gonna? Was there anything in the news today that was major?
Not really, thanks. Not different than the last 48 hours. I would, 72 hours probably.
Was the Melania thing talking about abortion today, or was that yesterday?
I didn't hear anything she said. So
no, here's what happened. She wrote. She wrote a book.
Yeah.
And I guess
I heard that.
Yeah, she wrote a book, and in the book, she says that she is for abortion. You know,
right to choose. Yeah,
right to choose. And he came out and said it's okay. She can believe whatever she wants to believe. I allow her that. She's her own person, and blah blah blah. Became a very liberal husband. You know. But she said she was, she was for free choice. And I think, that's pretty good. I'm glad she did it, I think she's pretty pissed at that guy anyway,
She's just waiting for him to kick off and get his money.
Yeah, yeah. Now, I wonder what happens. She can divorce him, can't she? I mean, but they've got a prenup.
Oh, I'm sure she's got a yeah, he's probably got that covered well.
Yeah, well, I think she's got it covered well because she's probably got more money at this point than he does.
Right?
I don't know. Well, who was it? Forbes, I think, came out and said that he was worth $4 billion.
Yeah, he's like 113th on the list or something.
No, no, more than that.
Yeah, something way down there.
Yeah.
I mean, that should have pissed him off.
How much? $4 billion, you said?
They say about $4 billion, $4.3 billion. And I mean,
in all honesty, in today's world,
that's really nothing.
Not very rich.
That's not very rich. And I don't think he's got that.
In terms of world players, it's not.
Yeah.
I mean, there are some people on that list who could literally put $4 million in cash in an airplane and fly around and throw it out, you know?
Yeah. Yeah.
And have billions and billions more.
Number one was, again, was Elon Musk. Right. And he doesn't, no matter what he does, he doesn't seem to lose money. He still makes money. $230 billion. Yeah. On what? Last time we looked, he had $230 billion, right?
You know, when you're very wealthy, all the laws and systems are just really designed to work in ways that keep you in that, you know, keep you in that range. I mean, they don't have, I mean, the people in our tax bracket don't have the same kind of features and, you know, bullshit rules, you know, for us as people like that. I mean,
it's
very hard to not stay rich, I guess, is my point there, which is why I don't understand how Trump was as big as he says he is never managed to, you know, stay that way.
Well, I remember one point where Bill Gates had something like $131 billion or something. I'm just throwing out a number here. Mm-hmm. And he said, well, I'm going to start giving it all away. And he started giving it all away. He spent a ton of money on his organizations, you know, and on his philanthropies. Mm-hmm. And he gave it away like crazy. He said,
they still are.
You know, when I die, why do I want to leave this money when it could have gone to some good? So he started spending it like crazy. And the next thing I looked, the next year he had like $150 billion. What happens there? I don't understand.
I mean, it's easier to make money when you have money, you know? I mean, when you can make money off investments and things like that, and the taxes that they pay on it are lower, you know? I mean, you know, it's much cheaper for them. So, you know, but he has given away a lot of his money. They still are. I mean, they have that foundation, and you know, there's a lot of people. I work with some people who think, you know, they're secretly, you know, like the cannibals who are grooming kids, and you know, they use their foundation for things like that or whatever. I mean, you know, but in real life, they give away a lot of money that operates a lot of pretty decent programs and things like that. And he's a member of that group that their goal was to give away like 80% of their worth.
Yeah.
Or something, you know. I think Warren Buffett might be in that.
As hard as he keeps trying, he can't seem to do it. I mean, the same thing is with Warren Buffett, who's a guy who kind of got him into philanthropy.
Yeah.
And Buffett said it was giving away his money like crazy, and he still got a hell of a lot of money.
Yeah, yeah. You know? Right, yeah. I mean, because they can continually make money. You know, it's easier to do that when you...
Let's face it, folks. If you have let's say you have $200 billion, why can't you give away $190 billion of it? You know, how much have you still got left?
Yeah.
Do you need that? You got all the big houses you ever needed. You got all the cars you ever wanted to own.
Yeah. Yeah. Look, I agree. I mean, it'd be.
And that's kind of their philosophy, but no matter how much they try and give away, they can't seem to get rid of it, you know?
Yeah, you know, that's what I'm saying. It's hard not to make money when you're already wealthy. It just is, I mean, it's almost like it's hard not to stay poor when you're poor, you know? I mean...
Well, can we come up with
the same thing?
Can we come up with the names of any billionaires who who haven't been able to maintain their billionaire status. Well, Donald Trump.
You know, I mean, you know,
they got a problem giving it away. I got a mailbox up.
I mean, if he's worth $4 billion, then he shouldn't have any problem paying his $680 million judgment like tomorrow, right?
Yeah, right.
Just to have the money delivered in a dump truck or whatever and be done with it.
Yeah. So
I know those worse are assets, blah, 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 blah. You know, well, then start selling shit, I guess. That's what I'd have to do. That's what you'd have to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, they'd tell me to sell my house and go live in a little fucking apartment or whatever if I owed people in the court and it had gone so far as for a court to order the payment. So.
Yeah.
You know, start selling your shit, just like Rudy Giuliani.
Well, I never had that kind of money. Well, Giuliani, there's a good example of a guy who probably had some money at one point. Doesn't have anything anymore.
Well, he's still managing to get around like he does because they haven't taken it all yet. But, I mean, there's a person, I mean, what has Giuliani ever done to have a house in Palm Beach and New York and Arizona and all this other? You know, I hope he ends up living in a fucking Motel 6 down there in fucking Brooklyn next to all the crackheads and fucking, you know, homeless people. That's fine.
Yeah, well, you
exactly
know,
what he deserves.
That's what he deserves, of course. But,
I didn't ask for anything bad to happen to him. I just said he should go live the lot in life that he carved out for himself, which is living under a bridge in New York, trying to see if he can get people to like him again.
You know, how far could somebody have fallen? I mean, that's the biggest fall, I think, in modern American history. This was America's mayor. That's what they called him. Remember that? America's mayor.
Yeah.
And we loved him.
I didn't.
Well, I did. And, you know, I mean, every day he'd get out on the phone and tell everybody what's going on. What's going to happen? What's we going to do? Here's what's happening.
He didn't save any lives by doing that. I'll tell you who saved lives by doing that was Cuomo, where he used to go on the air every night at like 7 o'clock and give everybody a pep talk and tell them to wear masks and here's what we're going to do. And, I mean, pretty good, you know? Pretty good. Decent guy, you know? So, I mean, he did something. All Rudy did was get on television every night and just calm people down. That was it, you know. While all his friends were robbing the city blind, but that's another story altogether, you know. Hello, Tom Yamaguchi. Two nights in a row. Boy, do I feel.
I heard Rudy Giuliani, and I just got an email from him today.
Did you really?
Would you like to see it?
Yes.
Donations?
Yeah. Can I share my screen?
Yeah, sure. I think you can. I don't know if you can.
Let's see if that's an option.
Mm-hmm.
I think it is. If you move your mouse around and choose the right.
Under more?
It's in there.
I don't see Sherry's screen.
No. Okay, maybe I don't have that available to you. Let me see.
Oh, bummer. But I could read it. It's got a really nice picture of him.
Yeah, yeah.
And it says, in red, white, and blue letters, it says, Rudy Giuliani Freedom Fund. Dear friend. That's how the Republicans send me emails, is friend.
Mm-hmm.
They used to send it to TOS or whatever. It was THOS. I don't know why, but now I'm just dear friend, and I'm a great patriot.
Dear friend, or it could be dear co-conspirator.
That's, right.
Yeah.
Anyway, it says, this is how Biden and Kamala want me to be remembered. Fulton County Jail inmate number P01135780. And then there's a black and white picture of Giuliani's mugshot from Georgia.
Those were full color mugshots. Why didn't he publish it in full color?
I don't know. Maybe he's cheap.
Cooler, black and white.
Oh, he's broke. That's right. He's broke. Anyway,
he couldn't afford color.
Couldn't afford color. Anyway, it continues. He says, and now their D.C. comrades just disbarred me in Washington, D.C. to stop me from holding them accountable in the court of law. These tyrants have taken away the very law license I used to defend President Trump as his lawyer. This comes after my license was taken away by the same New York Democrats who are trying to sentence President Trump to jail, and jail is all caps, 3 weeks after he wins the 2024 election. Let me be perfectly clear. I did absolutely nothing wrong, and nothing is underlined. The vengeful Democrats simply want to destroy me for serving as President Trump's lawyer and refusing to stop, to drop to my knees and surrender to the deep state tyrants who are killing America. And then it goes on and on and on, and then of course,
when he drops to his knees, I'll tell him what he can do.
And then it says, the Rudy Giuliani Freedom Fund, contribute $25, contribute $50, contribute $100, contribute $250, contribute $500, contribute other amount. Thank you, and God bless you. And it says, Rudy Giuliani.
Love how they throw that in at the end.
Yeah, it's a great email. I love my Republican emails.
Yeah, yeah. I don't get Republican emails. They don't waste their time on me.
It's amazing they wasted this much. I registered as a Republican in 2012.
Mm-hmm.
And why
did you do that? What was your thinking?
I was going to vote for John Huntsman, which, you know, Patrick Blazek also supported John Huntsman mm-hmm. in 2012. And I supported because he was actually a Republican that supported climate science. You know, it was actually accepted.
So that was the only way that you could vote for him.
Yeah, the presidential primaries are closed. Yeah. So I registered Republican. And then, of course, then registered Democrat after. And actually, John Huntsman dropped out. So I ended up voting for Fred Carger. You were stuck with being
a Republican.
I voted for Fred Carger. Who was the first openly gay president candidate on either party. So he beat out Pete Buttigieg. By the way, so I registered Republican or Democrat after the primary, mm-hmm. and I've been getting Republican emails ever since. I get them from
Just
Trump.
Just takes one.
I get them from Trump.
Wow. You know? Wow.
I'm a great patriot. I'm his biggest supporter. I would give him a penny. I'm his biggest supporter.
Yeah, I would like to get some mail from Donald Trump so I could wipe my ass with it.
I'll forward them to you.
Good, because I could use the toilet paper.
Well, you remember years ago, I was getting those too back when Phil was around, and I used to shred them up and stick them back in the envelope and send them back.
Oh, yeah, I haven't gotten any real hard copy letters. I did get one from Trump, and actually I got, you know, those ACLU pocket constitutions.
Mm-hmm.
I put a bunch of stuff in it, which was it's a postage paid envelope. So make sure it's a postage paid envelope. Put all that stuff and sent it back to him, and they had to pay the postage.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I always made sure. They were prepaid.
Yeah, but then they got smart. Yeah. Then they got smart, and then they said envelopes that require a stamp. So
it was still worth the stamp to me.
I'm a member of a couple organizations, like the American Organization of American Historians, the American Historical Association, four or five more. They sell your name, you know, to other places.
Yeah.
Or stuff like that. So I will get stuff in the mail, I mean, every single day. It's out of control. Asking for money to donate things, you know, American Battlefield Trust and all that. But what I've gotten a couple times, it's hilarious, is I can't remember what they named the organization. I could probably look it up, but Glenn Beck and a few other of those crazy people have bought some land in Utah. And I sent this to Kyle and Patrick before, and they are going to go out to Utah and build a replica of Independence Hall and one or two other things so that it can become a tourist attraction so that tourists taking their vacations out west can go out there and take tours of it, and they can learn about the true history of the American Revolution, you know, which is how I got these things sent to me, because I'm a member of the Society for Historians of the Early American Republic and a few other things. So they must have gotten my name. And, you know, they want me to send them money because they're trying to build this Independence Hall replica, full-scale Independence Hall replica, and some other building. I can't remember what else.
I think it was the Capitol building, and they're going to practice there.
Something, you know, yeah. I mean, it was, I mean, like, and they are trying, I mean, they're spending, like, tens of millions of dollars on this, as you can imagine. And I remember where in Utah it was. I think, you know, they located it fairly centrally, probably somewhere right off I-70. But, I mean, it's just like, what in the hell's wrong with these people?
Did they ever build? Wait a minute.
I mean, you're going to stop out there and get the true history, you know? And, you know, there's this big deal about how, you know, people who live out there, it's so expensive for them to travel to Philadelphia and all.
Yeah, so we can do it halfway.
You know, but... it's like, who's going to be teaching this real history? You know, I mean, I mean, like,
yeah, what books are they going to use?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I mean, I don't know if there's like some fascist dissident, Russia that escaped from the gulag or whatever. But
how long ago was this that you got this mail?
The last one that I got was probably 3 months ago.
Oh, really?
No, this is an active deal. Yeah, they've asked me. I probably got the same mailer like, you know, three times in the last year.
They like it.
You know, because like I said, they probably got my name from a couple
of they started building it all?
I don't believe they have. They're in the process of stealing money at the moment, and they'll probably never build anything, you know?
Yeah, that's like they're building Trump's wall for him.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. I mean, what they'll end up saying is that it didn't work out, and they used the money to pay off the land, and the rest went to, you know, like administrative fees or whatever, which is a nice way of saying Glenn Beck and Sean Hannity split $2 million, you know, between them. It was Glenn Beck and Sean Hannity and somebody else. I'd have to look.
You're going to need the money pretty soon.
I mean, it was very bizarre. You know, it was bizarre. I mean, I was just, like, some of the things that was in their little letter to me, I took pictures of it, and I sent it to those guys. Because, I mean, it was just like, you know, are you tired of your children being taught to hate America and their public school, you know, the whole line, you know what I mean?
Yeah. And I'm those are my Heritage Foundation.
Right. Yeah, but basically, yeah. I mean, it's like, what the world is wrong with these people? I mean, I just don't, you know, and the Heritage Foundation, a whole other thing when it comes constitutionally. They actually used to have some constitutional guidance that I could sort of agree with. I mean, they had a Heritage Foundation Guide to the U.S. Constitution that I quoted once or twice in the first master's degree that I did in the thesis, which was on the Constitutional Convention. I quoted a thing or two from their guide, you know, because it had some reasonable stuff in there about some of the early intentions and things like that. You know, it was reasonable. I don't know that I agreed with all of it, but it was reasonable enough, you know, that it was, I could put it into the argument and some analysis. But now they've just gone, because of Trump, they just make stuff up that I know they can't believe. I mean, that's what I'm saying. I just don't understand, because they see it as like their ticket to power or whatever, you know, I assume, or money or whatever.
Project 2025.
All the above. Oh, yeah, they're a hardcore, you know,
organization. I got a question about Project 2025, though. How realistic is it that it becomes a guide for a future president? Or is it just
already implementing it?
I mean,
thanks to Trump's Supreme Court.
Realistic for Trump, I would say realistic. Realistic for anybody other than Trump, I would say anybody else not named Trump would probably throw it in the trash and just keep walking. You know?
I mean,
Trump away from me.
Trump claims he doesn't even know what it is.
Well, that's a bunch of lies, but I mean, pretty much anybody else would take their little book and throw it in a waste can and look at somebody and be like, your fucking job from now on is to make sure that I don't get my picture taken or stand within 10 feet in a room of any of the fucking people that had anything to do with this. And if I do, you're fired. You know, that's what a normal Bill Clinton, George W. Bush would do, right? You know, with these radical people, you know, your job is to make sure that I don't end up getting my picture taken.
I don't want to be seen with these crazy loons. Yeah.
You know, but Trump is of no such You know, it's act like they're great on Monday because you're talking to this group of people. And then on Tuesday, I've never met any of those people. I've never even met anyone that's met anyone that's met those people. You know, I mean, so all made up bunch of lies, period. He knows exactly who they are and he knows exactly what they want. You know, and we've been talking about this for a couple years, but I'm seriously saying that historically, you get to a certain point where, you know, fascists just start telling you what it is they want to do. You know, like way back, they start with innuendo and suggestions and talking, or you know what I'm saying? So that just the people that, you know, are on their side hear them, and then they watch. I mean, we've reached the point now where they're just, they're not really afraid to write it down and print it out in a book anymore. Okay, no. Because, you know, that's one step further on the road to something that you can't turn around and come back from without some sort of major conflict. The Confederacy, you know, hemhawed around about the slavery deal for a long time, and then, you know, it just got stronger and stronger, and then finally it was... You know what? This is what we want. If you don't like that, we'll succeed, you know? And that's not really the same as a fascist regime like the Nazis, et cetera. But I'm saying the parallels are close enough. You know, I mean, the playbook for people like that is fairly well written. They don't have to invent anything new. Our job is to just recognize it and understand that that's what they're trying to do. And I mean, I recognize it. Now, what hurts my brain is that I can't see how there are normal people in America who can't see it. You know, and will make up excuses for not only for themselves, but for them. I don't understand that.
Right.
But, you know, as I've said before, I got a degree in history, not psychology. You have to go talk to, you know, that department is across the hall. You know, you got to go talk to them. I don't know that I can answer that. I'm serious. You got to go talk to psychology about that. I don't know. I mean, I guess I can guess, but I mean, they want to be liked. They want to fit in with a group. You know, they want to feel important. They want power. They want, you know, whatever. But you'll have to. I mean, I'm sure there are people that study that, and I can't get it. I can't get how people know that it's wrong. I mean, they know the stuff they're saying.
Well, you know, I mean, what was it, the old saying, never underestimate the intelligence of the American public, you know? And the fact is that the public here is pretty stupid, you know? Pretty stupid. Here comes, I think, Ray Renati, who we haven't seen in a while.
Well, they're at least naive, you know, at a minimum, a lot of them, you know?
Yeah. I mean, I just think that there is a stupidity out there I can't believe, because, you know, in my whole lifetime, I remember people running for president. And if anybody even had some of the baggage that Trump has got, people wouldn't even think about him seriously as a guy running for president. But here he is. This is totally immoral sot. You know, who these people are following. And I'm going, what America were you born into? You know, what country did you grow up in that you can honestly sit down and believe this crap? And that you find him acceptable? I mean, come on, you're a Christian and you don't mind his morals? Are you out of your mind? What kind of Christian are you?
Forget the morals. What about his record? I mean, I can't believe people said, oh, he's so great on the economy. He destroyed the economy. He mishandled the pandemic.
Well, what they said is everybody...
He destroyed the economy, and Biden was left to pick up the pieces, and now says, oh, you didn't pick up the pieces fast enough. You know?
Well, no, I mean, the fact of the matter is that everybody has really short memory. They don't remember how bad he was when he was bad. They can't remember the reason why people voted for Biden instead of Trump. If he was as good as he says he is, they would have reelected him.
Right.
You know? but he didn't have the record to run on. That was the problem, you know.
Yeah, national polls, you know, I saw another one today that has up over 50%, you know, so.
Who?
That's good.
Oh, who?
Harris?
Harris, yeah.
Yeah.
I got a few polls here. There are a whole bunch of different ones.
And, you know, in a national head-to-head, she was just over 50%, and he was at just under 48%.
Here's one called ActiVote, and Harris is up plus 12.
Okay, right.
That seems, you know. I don't believe that, but...
Yeah, the problem is you've got to just look at the swing states. I mean, that's what's going to come down to. You know, that's what it always comes down to. It doesn't matter what the national polls are.
Right.
You know, because Trump continually loses on the national popular vote.
I mean, there was at least good evidence, you know, I think we talked about a week or so ago, that once a candidate had gotten into that, like, 51% range... that person's path to winning the Electoral College is almost, you know, I don't think it hasn't happened, you know, because Hillary Clinton didn't hit that, I don't believe, for example. So,
okay,
it's just positive news. I mean, it doesn't, like Tom said, doesn't make a difference. I mean, you know, how many times you turn on a game and they said, you know, this team's beat this team 7 straight times. Well, you know. They got to play today, right? So,
right.
You know, it looks good, but that doesn't mean, you know, anything till they play the game. So, I mean, we'll see.
Well,
I mean,
they're saying that there's a what we call the silent vote out there. The people who are going to vote for Harris who aren't saying so to the pollsters, you know. And the pollsters are getting it all wrong again. It's basically because they're pollsters. I mean, look at how they poll. You sit there with a clipboard, and they say, who are you going to vote for? And the person's standing out there in public. It's not in the sanctity of a voting booth, you know? And they're going to say what they think their friends would want to hear them say. So, of course, okay, I'm for Trump. All right.
It's not even that. I mean, it's basically them calling until they get somebody actually picks up the phone, which is usually people that like who are not like me. I don't recognize that. I'm not picking up the phone.
I think they're doing it a different, slightly different way now because they realize only 50% of America have telephones now. They have cell phones,
right?
You know, and that they've really got to start going out after these people in a different way than they did in the past.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, we'll see. I don't pay any attention to the polls, really.
Yeah, right. I mean, what data that we've seen has been positive for Harris, you know, which is good. I mean, I'd rather have it that way than, you know, not, I guess, right? But... It's nothing until people turn out and vote for
it. But you know, I'll tell you where it only depends on where you watch. I tend to watch all the major news networks because I like to see how they're parsing it. And I got to tell you, I hate MSNBC. I mean, I just feel like they're sucking my dick. Okay, you know, they're just trying to keep me happy. But then I go over to Fox, and they're the same goddamn thing on the other side. I mean, I watch it, and it's like going into Bizarro World. You know, it's a completely different world over there at Fox. On top of that, they have a different set of commercials than they have on MSNBC.
Really? I thought they were all selling prescription medicines because of because their viewers are all old people like us.
Well, it's a different set of prescription medicines on Fox than you get on MSNBC. Yeah.
Different side effects. Huh?
Yeah, yeah. And I don't know what it is with the advertising right now, but there is an overabundance of please send money to these poor kids. You know.
Oh, that. Yeah.
I mean, and I don't know why right now they're in such preponderance. It could be. That what's happened is that these news outlets aren't really making money. And they have to take whatever they can get. And the price is cheap, and it's cheap enough for these people to take out time. Now, I happen to like St. Jude's. Okay, so I don't mind their ads because they don't show you a bunch of pathetic kids. They show you crying parents, but they don't show you crying kids. They show you happy kids, kids who are getting well, you know, parents who are gratified that, you know, they've got some place to take them. But you go to these other ones like the Shriners, for crying out loud, and they got kids that look pathetic, you know, and they just want to make you feel so guilty that you didn't send them your money. But all I'm saying is I see a preponderance of these ads. I mean, I saw one news break a couple of days ago where the whole 2 minutes was taken up with these kind of organizations, whether it was St. Jude's or whether it was the Shriners or, you know, Cars for Kids, you know.
And a number of these advertisements are more than 1 minute, you know, like the, what's it, Humane Society or something? They show all these pathetic, all these poor sick,
the pathetic.
And I would swear that some of them might be 3 or 4 minutes.
With the animals really bother me because they sit there and they've got an animal that looks pathetic because he's chained up and he hasn't been fed. And I'm saying, you know, you could really go over and feed these animals and unchain them. But no, you're not because you want to get a good shot of these dogs looking pathetic.
Well, they unchain them after they unchain them
afterwards, yeah.
But I'm just saying, you know, I don't even have a TV. So I don't, the only time I see these news channels is when I'm working for somebody else. I've got, you know, I have people that I work for that you know, MSNBC is on constantly, you know. And so that's the only time I see these news channels, and I don't want to waste my time with them. I mean,
Marjorie loves watching MSNBC. And I keep telling her, you know, stop it already, you know?
Well, you know, what really irritates me about it is that basically, you know, Fox came on, you know, it's been a conservative argument for the very big, going back to Goldwater, that the TV or the liberal media, you know, the media is biased against conservatives, and so Fox came on with this premise that, well, we're going to be fair and balanced. That means that, you know, the media has been unfair to conservatives, so we're going to provide the balance by being overly, you know, giving just the conservative news. Okay, we're providing that balance. We're giving the conservative news. And then MSNBC comes along and say, well, if they're going to give conservative news, then we're going to give liberal news. And so basically they're buying into the premise that news is biased, that news has a political, as I said, bias.
Yeah. Yeah.
And that's really dangerous. Well,
you know, years ago when, what's his name, Roger
Ailes
started Fox. Actually, he had started before that with a thing called, before MSNBC was MSNBC, it was called Talk America. And it was run by Roger Ailes. And then he went over to Fox. And his theory was, you know, The other networks are liberal, and we want to give the conservatives something that speaks for them.
Yeah.
And I saw that as a great idea. Fine, you know, balance the whole thing out. But the thing is, they just went too far, and they made too much money, and they couldn't stop lying through their teeth. You know, there was no objectivism at all finally. And it was terrible. Well, you know, MSNBC makes the same mistake. Oh, well, now we'll go on over the other side. You know, but if you think about it, if you look at all the channels on television, there's only one channel that's left-wing, and that's MSNBC. CNN tries to be in the middle. Of course, by being in the middle, everybody thinks they're liberal, but they're not. I've watched them. They're pretty much, you know, they're liberal. They're rather in the middle. Then you go over to Fox. Fox very much to the right, right? But then you got Newsmax, and you got this one other, you know, that's on systems everywhere across the country. So there are more conservative outlets out there than there are liberal. Mm-hmm. So the fact is that the news is not fair and balanced anywhere, you know.
Well, the big problem with the TV or the cable news networks is they're all focused on American politics.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a whole big world out there. There's a lot of stuff going on in the world.
Yeah.
And all they're talking about is Republicans versus Democrats. I mean, I listen to the BBC, you know, because I want to hear what's going on in the world.
And probably, you know? If you were British, you'd think they sucked, you know.
I think the Brits love their BBC.
Well, they did love it. They don't love it as much as they used to.
Yeah.
You know, the BBC, they used to take great pride in, but it's had some scandals over the years that it hasn't made people that happy with the BBC. But all I'm saying is we don't have any real balance here. I mean, if those people went on the air, I mean, Fox calls themselves fair and balanced. They're not. They're lying to their audience. Okay. And they shouldn't do that. They're a news organization. They shouldn't lie to anybody. They shouldn't take sides. They should report the goddamn news. That's what I tune in to get. Mm-hmm. And all I get is propaganda. And I'm tired of it, you know? So that's my case, and I'm sticking to it. Hi, Ray. You haven't said a thing tonight.
Well, I'm just listening. Yeah, I listen. I watch the French news on my Roku. It's really good. Mm-hmm. In English. They report on everything around the whole world. It's just excellent.
Yeah.
I think it's French 5. Yeah.
Yeah. How are they parsing the whole Mideast situation?
They just report on what's going on. I mean, they don't really have... You know, it's kind of like the days of Walter Cronkite. They're not really, they don't have a horse on any one side. They just report it.
Yeah.
Which I think is what we used to want. That's what I appreciate. I mean, if somebody is doing something, I mean, they will report the things that people are, you know, being immoral about or unethical or whatever you want, but they don't blow it out of proportion and like they do here.
Do you know who amazingly has started ewing towards the center? And I may be wrong. People disagree with me if you want to. Drudge is kind of more towards the center now.
I never looked at that anymore.
Than he's ever been, you know.
He used to be really right-wing, right?
Well, he was right-wing, but basically he was just, you know, he was simply a link to other stories elsewhere, okay?
Yeah.
But he kind of chose the stories, and now he seems to be very much against Trump, like he has no love for Trump at all, okay?
So, what amazes me about Trump is the January 6th thing. I mean, that just... For me, that's just the nail in the coffin. I mean, it should be. You look at somebody like Richard Nixon. I mean, look what happened when he pulled that crap. I mean, the Republicans went against him, his own party.
Yeah.
And Trump did something arguably worse, and it's as if nothing happened.
Yeah. Well, they didn't have people like Barry Goldwater to go into the White House and say, "We're going to impeach you. You better resign," you know?
I will say that if Trump doesn't win this election, that's it for the Republican Party. They're going to have to go back and reassemble, you know. They're going to have to change their whole modus operandi. You know, something I want to bring up here, it's interesting, you know, you know, stuff on TV and so on can change the tone of something after many years. What do you think is the biggest show right now on streaming?
The Menendez Brothers show.
That's exactly, you got it exactly right.
Monsters.
Yeah, Monsters. Big, huge ratings. Guess what's just happened? The district attorney in L.A. wants to reopen the case. You know, and it took TV to do that.
It's like Scott Peterson. Truman Show. Thing.
Scott Peterson.
It's a Truman
Show. Yeah.
Same thing. They had a documentary on him, and then they opened up the case again.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
What's happening?
Yeah, there's been a few.
Yeah. In fact, it says here, Menendez brothers could go free at a November hearing. Mm-hmm. They probably won't. But supposedly what I read was the attorney in L.A. is reopening, looking at the case again, because they're beginning to think, well, maybe they got a raw deal. Mm-hmm. Why did you think we got a raw deal? Well, we saw the TV show. that's where we saw them get a raw deal. So that's kind of interesting, you know, that's the power of media now. To be able to change things.
You can't go kill your parents because they're abusing you. Then, you know, every kid in the United States who has abusive parents could go and murder them. I mean, it's ridiculous.
Well, still, you know, if they were abused as much as they say they were abused. And what's interesting about I don't know if you've seen the Menendez story.
When it happened, I watched the entire trial.
Yeah, but
on
I don't. If you haven't seen this thing, what they do is they take kind of both sides of the story. They don't. They let you make up your mind. You know.
Yeah.
First they show their side of the story, then they show the parents' side of the story, and they kind of end up saying the parents weren't that bad, basically. You know.
Oh, okay.
But you know, I mean, it's. It was a hell of a story, and it's a great show. So we were riveted to it, you know, and because we have no taste at all. So, you know, and the other thing I watched all of was that thing on the guy who ran the WWF, WWE, Vince McMahon.
It was McMahon.
Like a six part show on him. And his history, and it was fascinating too. One of the more
he was a character.
Yeah, one of the most fascinating parts of the show is when they show, you know, Trump appearing in wrestling matches, and they think he got a lot of the idea of how to act to the American public by going on wrestling TV or wrestling shows and having to play that whole game of, you know, being larger than life and so on and so forth. And that some of the people on that show said he got everything he knows from us.
Trump wrestled?
Huh?
Did you say that Trump was a professional wrestler?
Well, he went on to the WWF or WE. They changed the name of it. Way back when he appeared as a character there, and he wrestled McMahon.
Oh wow! I didn't know that.
he would jump on people and they would punch him and you know, but he then would get on and do all this yelling and screaming like wrestlers do. You know, I'm gonna get this guy because he And he kind of learned how to be that kind of entertainer there, and is using it now. So
he is for sure using it.
Pretty amazing, pretty amazing. But oh well, we got another. What is it? 32 days? Is it something like that? Something close to that.
Can't wait till it's over with.
Well, maybe you won't want to be. See, we're going to Europe on the 7th of November.
Oh, I just got back yesterday. Yeah. I just got back from France yesterday. Yeah, I have the worst jet lag.
We're going to France on the 7th. I'm going to be there for about 5 days. And we've decided that if he wins the election, we're not coming back. we're immediately running over to the French embassy and asking for amnesty.
Asylum.
Yeah.
Ask for asylum.
Yeah.
Anyway, that's it for tonight. Well, it's great having you all here. And an intelligent bunch, too, I might add. Not the same stupid knuckleheads we usually have. No, I'm just kidding. Thank you, Josh. Won't see you tomorrow night. You got to work. Jeff, great talking with you and having you here. Kevin, Delightful, delightful. Tom Yamaguchi, two nights in a row for Tom. This is like a record lately.
I couldn't resist talking about Rudy Giuliani.
That's right. And of course, Ray, thank you so much for joining us tonight. I appreciate it. Join us anytime. Welcome back from France. In the meantime, everybody give a big wave goodbye, and I'll give a big wave goodbye at you, okay? There they go. That's our citizen panel for tonight, folks. There'll be another one starting any moment now with our good friend Amy Manuel, and she has one that will be on, let's see here, we use Skype over there, and it'll be GabNet Live that you call with Skype. I'll see you again tomorrow night. Same time, same station in life. And in the meantime, as always, if you see her, you know, tell her I love her, okay? Good night, everybody.